there. Thank you for joining us today on Millennial Talk, where we discuss issues affecting millennials and give recommendations on how to deal with them. So if this is your first time joining us, you're most definitely welcome. And if you're a returning person, thank you for joining us today and thank you for starting Millennial Talk. So in the past month, we've been discussing career. So we discussed mistakes millennials make, you know, when they're trying to get a job. Last week, we discussed how to get past the waiting period. So when we're waiting for a new job. But my name is Bukunmi, and I will not be having this discussion alone. And I'll introduce my co-host, Josephine. Hi.
Hi, Bukunmi. You know, it's actually been quite, a learning process for anyone who is, you know, on the hunt for a job. We've gone from the process of, okay, how do you overcome the mistakes you make when you're trying to get land a dream job? And then we went to, now you're sent out your CVs and you're waiting. What do you do next? And today we are going to be moving further with the conversation.
Exactly. Landing a dream job can be very exciting and fulfilling. Yay! I have a new job, right?
Yeah.
But you have to prove all those grammar you were speaking during the interview and all the lexicons and everything you put on your CV, you have to prove it.
Yeah.
So most times, the probationary period, that's what they call it. So most times it's like for some companies is like 3 months, for some 6 months, and even 9 months. But how do you get past this period? So that exciting thing, the first ginger, and you're all geared up for a new job.
Mm-hmm.
But many times when you start to face feedback, you start to get, you have to prove yourself. You have to show that you actually know the job.
Mm-hmm.
You have to, ensure that what you put on paper matches with, the amount of, work you put out on the job. So how do you get past that period? So for some people, you see that the motivation starts to drop when they start to get feedback from their superiors and all of that. So, Josephine, that's what we are.
that's definitely what we're talking about. And you're quite right. Personally, I've actually faced a situation like that where when I started, I was super excited. In fact, before I landed the job, I was like, yeah, it's coming. And when it came, I was very excited. But getting on the job, new expectations, and, you putting in your best, but it might not, because every work culture is different. So wherever you're coming from is different from where you're going to. So a lot of millennials tend to have they struggle with fitting into the organizational culture. And as a result of that, some of them might start to, lose focus on what should be. And sometimes it might not necessarily be that. It might be that they start to get tasks that were outside what is in the papers, because you get a contract from your employer. And it has your JD. Now, most of the times when you get on the job, you're doing much more than what was in that paper. So a lot of people struggle with all this other side. And then some jobs require you to take on tasks. Like they'll tell you that, fine, your scores depend on what you're doing as your JD. But they also tell you that, look, we expect you to take things outside your JD to prove yourself. So when you're in a situation like that, how do you deal with it? A lot of people might be asking, okay, this is not what I signed up for. I never thought, this is not what I signed up for, So if you are someone who's going through something like that, like you're already on the job, maybe you're 1 month into and you're struggling with what is going on at the moment, this conversation is definitely for you to know how you can get past that probationary period. And we also have a conversation. We're not having this conversation alone, of course. We have someone who has the oil in the head.
Exactly.
And with us, we have Kelvin Chiazor, a consultant from PCL. Welcome to the show.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Josephine, and thank you, Bukola. I'm really excited to be here, and I'm hoping we're able to make great impact to all the millennials who are watching, and even beyond the millennials, because this is also important for employers, because they play vital role in ensuring a smooth sale for those employees they hire.
Yeah.
And also there's a lot of cost that is being driven in the process of selection and hiring or firing. And it's a big interest for them that they're able to retain the employee, those they bring on board to drive a sale with them. So let's hope it's a good one.
I'm sure you're expecting,
You to pour the oil.
So tell us how you started your career and just give us a brief about Phillips Consulting.
Okay, so the most of my career, I started off my career on my own.
Okay.
Wow.
But of course, just like you've mentioned, there is that gap when you come out of school and you're trying to make it out there in the compete in the job market. It's a whole lot of challenge. Yeah. But in most of my career in taking a job, I've been opportunity to be involved in a number of HR consultancy and business strategy assignments. I've also had the opportunity of managing about 600 talents, over 600 talents across various organizations. Okay. Yeah, and so whenever I had the opportunity to discuss how these talents could excel in their career at an early stage, it's always been exciting. And I think it evolved to become a passion for me. And so that's why it's also fun that I'll be talking about it today. It's also interesting that the organization I work with, Phillips Consulting, is one that is also passionate about people. And we're renowned for transforming people possibilities, both internationally and here in Nigeria. We're an ingenious company, a leading ingenious business and management consulting firm. And for over close to 29 years, we've been in the business of supporting organizations to build a robust people management framework that has helped their business to be sustainable. It's very key. It will interest you that why we consider this topic very important to millennials. I can bet you that for business leaders, this is even more important for them.
Yeah, so understand the minds of the people they're trying to work with. And I think this can, you know, give more light to that perspective. Mm. I think one of the most important questions that would follow is, because people want solutions. So the next big question should be, how? So what are the important things that millennials or, you know, new employees should not ignore in order to make it past the probationary period? At least five.
So I will even start first from helping them understand what exactly that probation period is about.
Yeah, okay, exactly. That's great.
It's important that they recognize that it's a contract you're going into. Mm-hmm. Yes, the employer, you're giving the employer an opportunity to ascertain that you're going to display the potential that is required for you to succeed on that job. It's an opportunity for the employer to watch. But at the same time, it's also an opportunity for you to watch, mm-hmm, if it's a place you want to work.
Important. Yeah.
So, you know, when that understanding comes in, I think some level of comfort comes to the side of the employee to recognize that he's empowered to also make decisions in that period. In fact, I should mention that employees have the right, before you get on board in that organization, people don't know this, but you have a right to negotiate your probation period. You have a right to negotiate it. It's one of the clauses in your employment. So yes, a whole lot of focus goes to the monetary side, the rewards, the benefits. But at the same time, when you know what you bring into the table, it opens you up to, and also depend on the kind of situation in which you're coming in. You may have been within the framework of the business, and this is a new opportunity. You have the opportunity to negotiate what level of probation should be. At least the organization already has an insight into your potentials, and so you can negotiate. But what I'm driving at is that when people recognize that this is a contract, and it's a contract you are mutually coming to terms with, you are agreeing on, it empowers you to gain confidence to excel in that period. You know, because the moment an employee loses that confidence, it's going to impact on his performance. Yes. Confidence is key to excel in your probation period. And I think that's the number one thing that an employee has to ensure he safeguards. If he can have that in place, then it's, of course, he's on the right track to excel in. Yeah. But if we now then come to looking at some other important factors, coming back to your question. Looking at five things, yes, I would say he should maintain that confidence, recognize that he has value, that he's got to present to the organization. Okay. He's going to meet a number of challenges. But the first thing is recognizing your Bible for that institution, and that's your job description. Mm-hmm. You need to acquaint yourself with your job description, because there it has highlighted not just what you are expected to do. Mm-hmm. A detailed job description, if you're coming into a good organization, will highlight for you the key competencies, both technical and behavioral, things that you need to excel on that job. So it gives you the opportunity to take further steps. That will be taking out, doing good self-evaluation to know where exactly am I on the pedestal? How positioned am I? What new learnings do I need to have? That in itself will position you to know what kind of learnings, what kind of support would you need. When you go into an organization, most times you're not hired because you're the best. You're hired because you have demonstrated the enthusiasm to be the best. That's what you've done. And I think organizations are interested in people who have a mindset for continuous development. And if they, and not just continuous development in every direction, but the fact that you've identified what is required of you and you're beginning to pick up the skill sets that are required for you to excel in that direction. But it's also important that one recognizes that you will need relationships to excel. You need relationships to excel in the organization, and it's key that you identify with those relationships. And of course, you must get consistent feedback. You want to ensure that you're checking up with your manager. And in fact, in checking up with your manager, that should even, the moment you're done with the job description, you should go do an objective check. Okay. With your manager, yes, there's a job description, so but why do you hire? What exactly? For what reason did you hire me? Okay. What are the quick wins? What are the important things that you're hoping to achieve for hiring me? There are several candidates, but there's a particular reason you were that choice. Yeah, right. It's important if you know it. It gives you the opportunity to make a very good first impression.
And leverage on it, right?
You leverage on it. Yeah. And make an outstanding impression. But if you lose sight of that, then there's every tendency that you may chase the wind and forget about the important factors.
Okay, so thank you for that insightful explanation. But you know, she mentioned something about fitting into the work culture, which you also expatiated on. Mm-hmm. But what are those characters that you know an employee or a new employee can develop or would have that would affect their efficiency during the probationary period? So some people just think, I'm good, I'm intelligent, I know what I'm supposed to do, but how well can an employee fit into the culture of an organization?
I think that's important.
You know, Bukola, you've highlighted a very important question. Mm-hmm. Now, why is it important? It's important because it throws light on a huge gap we have in our educational system, a very huge gap. And HR people who are very much involved in recruiting, that they're quick to identify the massive gulf between the knowledge presented in the schools and the expectations in the workplace.
Yes, I think HR makes that mistake.
In fact, that's why you have a number of organizations that have begun to throw out some level of intervention, but they're still not doing enough. Now, I think it's easy to find that in maybe an HR outsourcing space where they have to deal with a huge number of employees or candidates. Mm-hmm. So there you're dealing with 2,000 candidates, you're doing three, and out of the 3,000 candidates, you're finding it difficult to still get the right people for your employer. You have a huge database, 13,000 database, but yet you're finding it difficult to hire. And so I remember in working in that environment, one of the initiatives we began to put forward is to develop these candidates. I know that PCL, Phillips Consulting, during the lockdown, were very big on that. Mm-hmm. We had a number of short courses that we're sending out that were going for as little as nothing. You could learn online. It was a learning spree for almost technically free for everybody. And that's because we recognize the big gap that exists between what we learn in school
and what you have to implement.
In fact, the learning there's a lot of difference in how we learn. Mm-hmm. So when you come into the workplace, you're learning collaborative work. Mm-hmm. It's important. Yeah. But how are we trained in our learning system? We're trained to do things alone.
Competition.
Your assignment is alone.
Yes.
Yeah, that's very true.
Your exam.
A lot of collaborative work.
Your exam is alone.
Except maybe some special classes where they say you have to do a science project together, only in cases like that.
Which is very rare. Mm-hmm. And in fact, there's no strong emphasis when that project is going to be marked. sometimes because
that leads this, they'll just take control.
So there's no, then don't think about it. In the workplace also, you're expected to fail big, fail and struggle well. That's an important thing, but that's not the mindset that we learn in school. In school, you have to pass. That's
so important.
That's what, and unfortunately, also coming to millennials, how we are today. Some people tell me I'm not a millennial, but I believe I am a millennial. But you know, interestingly, if you look at millennials, if you think about us, we're very dynamic when it comes to culture. And not only that, our demands can be very interesting. And it's not uncommon because our experience in developing from going to school, it's far different from what the older generation experienced. There were skills that they quickly learned, soft skills that they were quickly able to pick up before they got into the workplace that a number of millennials have not had the opportunity to have. And that's why when you look at the resilience of a millennial, you may not exactly compare with the higher generation. And why is that? While the older generation had to learn time management from going to the farm early in the morning by 6 a.m. and then going back to do...
My dad always said that every time.
And then going back to still attend class, he had to deal with stress. Stress management, people don't teach, may not teach you. If someone says, but I had so much stress writing an exam, come on. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about doing something totally different from the course you're pursuing. You have to multitask. You have financial deliverables that you have to cover. Probably you were selling for your father, or if you were an Igbo guy, you were an apprentice somewhere. And from doing your apprentice work, you had to go back to the shop and continue the business. And you had to deliver. You had to be awake. You had to be strong. So there's a resilience that they've learned. But we haven't had our institutions building that in us. So answering the question, what kind of behaviors? These are the behaviors that we're looking at.
Yeah.
Soft, they're very soft, but very important. Like you've mentioned, especially during the introduction, you'll find that a lot of graduates, I can tell you we're producing very bright graduates today, especially in Nigeria. Nigerians are generally bright. So both from Nigeria or from the diaspora, we present ourselves as very strong candidates. But most times when we look at it, it's from a technical, from the technical skill sets.
Yeah.
How the question now becomes, how prepared are you to face the organizational politics you're going to meet when you get in there?
The bureaucracy.
How well are you ready to? And you know, in looking at culture, coming back to culture, you know, there's a tendency for a millennial to go into an organization and with so much expectation he has, there's a need sometimes for you to slow down and display the fact that you appreciate the value of the legacy culture you're meeting there. That culture is what has built that organization to where it is.
So you don't just rush and start doing show yourself.
It's good to show yourself, noting that you're going in there to become a catalyst to help that organization's culture to evolve, but not necessarily to run it down. So you have to first appreciate the culture you're meeting there, recognize its value, see how it has helped the organization so far, and see how you can become the catalyst to help that culture evolve to where we all believe it should be, especially in this digital age.
Wow, that's exciting.
Great, very insightful. Earlier you mentioned at the beginning that we're not just going to talk about the employees now. Yes, this is to solve a problem for the employees, but we also want to talk to the employers as well, because they also have something to pick up from here.
Yes.
So the big question now is, what roles does the employer have to play in helping the employee get past this period? Because as much as is the responsibility of the employee to get past this period, it's also the responsibility of the employer, because they have a role to foster this growth. So what should the employee or the employers be doing right to help these new onboarding employees move forward and get past the period?
Thank you for that question. You know, thinking about it, I think the first big mistakes employer would make is to define the probation period only by its start date and its end date. And it's typically what happens in most, in a lot of organizations. Whereas the probation period, there ought to be a set of programs that have that should have been defined for that period.
Okay.
A set of program that will support the employee. You someone may want to separate it from the onboarding program, but then or the induction, but it can be fused together. In I know that in some organizations, induction programs can go as far as 6 months.
Yes.
But and even a year, like you mentioned. But at the same time, there should be in every organization there should be a definite set of programs that will support that individual to settle in. Especially when you recognize that, recognize the cost of hiring. If you understand that, then you don't want to come to the end of the road and then when you do a review and take a look back and wonder, oh, what really happened? You find out, oh, this is where we missed it. The loss is already done. The damage is done, not just to the organization, but even to the candidate himself. You may end up impacting on that person's confidence and who knows how well he'll be able to excel in another environment. So it's important that we're able to put this in perspective when setting up the probation. And such probation program or set of programs must be such that is supportive. There must be a supportive system for it, as well as a culture, an enabling culture to support that program. That's very key for organizations. Another important thing that organizations must do, you know, I find it funny, both for the employee and for the employer, when everyone, HR comes at the end of the probation period and suddenly realize that, oh, we don't think we're going to...
No, has it happened before? Does it happen?
Really?
Sometimes. People get
You get to that point and they're like, I'm sorry, we don't think that you are a perfect match for the culture, or we just think that, you know, there's... And then I'm like, where did you get it wrong? Or because did I miss something?
It shouldn't, you know, if you're going, if the employee is going to exit the organization, it shouldn't be a surprise. Because in setting that program, you should have consistent feedback. There should be constant monitoring and assessment of the person's performance. So I will make that my third point. There should be constant monitoring and an assessment of his performance. If he has 6 months, what happened in the first month? What happened in the second month? What happened at the third month? And then all the way to the sixth month, and then you come and say, oh, we think you've been doing the wrong thing.
I feel like Nigerian employers maybe don't go in depth into these issues. I don't know, maybe for smaller companies. I don't know if multinationals do it at that level, but I feel like maybe they don't know, really do the diligence. HR doesn't do the, you know, groundwork. So why would probation be 6 months, then on the 6 months, you tell me I'm not
I will give it, I will give kudos to a number of organizations, not just multinationals, but even Nigerian firms. I would say that a lot of HR practitioners recognize these issues and are beginning to pay attention. However, sometimes it can be a complex process. And so you want to invite consultants to support support the development of such programs to ensure that it's robust and it addresses the key objectives for that. Because you're not just hiring one person, you're going to have several. So you want to have a robust induction program that accommodates your new intakes across different levels. Because it has to be diverse. You have those who are coming in at the junior at the entry level or as graduate trainees. You have those who are also coming in at mid level, and you have those who are coming in at the senior level. We've seen people part hands. It doesn't just happen at the junior level. Some people part hands even at top management level. So sorry, bye, I'm not going to be here. We've had issues like that. But I think where if they can, in fact, I will take it, let me even take it a step backwards. Where the HR practitioner recognizes that it's a game of number and he has cost in this, and not just in terms of financials, but in terms of time and investment, the investment you make in the employee. When you recognize this, it makes you more careful in carrying out your hire, in carrying out your recruiting or your talent management strategy becomes more robust. You want to make sure that you've eliminated all forms of bias by adopting very important tools that will help you assess assess behaviors. You know, it's easier to assess the technical skills of individuals. There are a number of tools that everyone is familiar with. In fact, what was common when people want to check, at least move beyond your, when they want to move beyond that critical engineering or technical skill, they try to do a GMAT test for you to check your level of intelligence and all. But we're going beyond that now. Mm-hmm. Because we're finding that people are not fired mostly because of the their skill sets.
Yeah.
It's usually because of soft issues, mm-hmm. people-related issues, culture,
character.
All these are the issues for which people are fired. And not because, you know, some people say the person is not culture fit. I try to avoid that word. I rather want to say, because if you think about it, there's really no good or bad culture. Mm-hmm. What I prefer to describe it is a culture variance. How dispersed is the culture variance? How far is the culture variance between the person you've hired and the expectation from the organization? Mm-hmm. So if you take note of that variance from the point of recruiting, then it saves you a lot of challenge. And from the point of recruiting, not just for the organization at large, but also for the job, right. There are behavioral competencies that are required for you to be a better salesperson or for you to deliver as a salesperson stresslessly. Yeah. And that's where there's a tool we work with, the Thomas International tool.
Personality
assessment. Yes. Good, you're familiar with that, the PPA, and some other trait emotional intelligence tests, even the high potential trait indicators, which will go as far as checking traits that are required for leadership. If you mm-hmm. think this person would have a future, if you're already looking at the long-term life of that individual in your firm, you want to quickly check those things and see where would this person fit better. Then in the team he's coming into, how well would this person fit into the culture of this team or the requirement by this team? So there are a number of tools out there.
Sorry to cut you short.
Go ahead, please.
But we'll be going on a short break now, and when we return, we'll continue the conversation.
And I told my mom, even engineering thing, I don't think it's my thing. Yeah, I went to school, I gave him a good grade, but I don't think that is what I actually want to do.
Get better at what you do. If you keep getting better, the followers will come.
I was going to run a business. Usually a business wants to deliver value, and you have to determine first, you know, what solutions, I mean, what are the needs available? What are the solutions that I can offer?
FCMB, my bank and I.
If you've joined us so far, thank you. I believe you've learned a lot of things, and we are back to continue the conversation. So the question I have, you know, next is the mental health. Everybody's talking about mental health, and I remember we discussed it in our last, you know, episode as to how, you know, you mentioned emotional intelligence, how, you know, employees can ensure they have soft skills necessary for the job. Mm-hmm. So new job, new environment, it's not easy to, you know, fit in anywhere, just like you're picking a fish, or I don't know, maybe dumping it into somewhere. So how can, you know, an employee get past, you know, that the emotional process and ensuring that their mental health, you know, is fit or is, you know, is stable through the job, through the probationary period?
Yeah, I would say first it's awareness.
Okay.
In this part of the world, mental health is
people don't talk about it. Like
they don't take it seriously.
There's a stigma around. Fine. There's a stigma around. If you say you're not mentally healthy, there's a problem.
Psychiatrist.
So you can imagine you were sitting by and I said, oh, you know, I'm not mentally okay right now.
like, so, I'm Nigerian. They're exactly. not strong.
Yes. Yeah. Strong. So good. So people say, oh, I think you're weak. I mm-hmm. think you're not mm-hmm. strong. But you see, everyone has to take note of the fact that both the employee and the employer has to recognize the challenges for millennials, especially mm-hmm. recognize this, or let me even say for new employees, they have to recognize the shadows they have to deal with. First, they're trying to familiarize themselves with the system. They have calls from different quarters. People
meeting new people.
Meeting new people, yeah. getting familiar. And also, they're under pressure to excel.
To prove themselves.
To prove themselves. And so you may have a situation where the person works himself all out and begin. And you know, that can also contribute to that diminishing return that follows when an employee gets into an organization mm-hmm. because he's mentally stressed and he's not very informed when it comes to work-life integration. He has not so much learned that. Thank God for remote work today. But unfortunately, it is also becoming a bigger problem because a number of people have not learned how to switch off.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So mm-hmm. That one, I feel like that one is like another entire
topic.
Issue.
A different yes. topic. Yes. Yeah. Yeah, because when you're working from home, it's hard to tell what your working time is and what you could be cooking and still working. You just rush out of the bedroom and you're still working. You know,
you know, if you're working on the island and you checked your time and it was 5 p.m., you remember home. That you have traffic you have to deal go. With. You have to switch off. Mm-hmm. And there's no way you go through. I think Lagos helps us to switch off.
Yeah, and I feel like sometimes employers feel like, oh yeah, Tom, what are you doing? Some employers, so you should be spending the extra time working. But anyway, just you can continue.
So I think we've addressed a lot of the issues, and one of the issues that I've one thing that a lot of people be looking forward to is, okay, so in a nutshell, what would be that golden ticket advice that you can give to an employee on how to get past the period, and then what you can give to an employer, like, how do I help these people? What is there a special structure that helps them get, you know, integrate, for them to integrate into the system to help these people move forward? And for the employees, what's that one, you know, in a nutshell, advice that you can give to them?
I would simply say, be composed, be confident, mm-hmm. Recognize it's your contract,
okay,
and you have a responsibility to wowing your employer. Mm-hmm. Don't get distracted. Focus on your job description. That's the only place you can have an argument. That if you come to that point where there's an argument about your performance, the reference is going to be your job description. Mm-hmm. Yes, there's going to be a lot of demands coming left and right, but ensure that in all you've fulfilled the requirements right. of the job description.
Okay, so when it comes to the
employer. And when it comes to the employer, it's obviously their job to create that enabling environment. Mm-hmm. That's the responsibility of the employer. It's a lot of cost hiring or losing employees. Mm-hmm. So you want to make sure that you create that enabling environment, give them the support, help them build supportive relationships mm-hmm. within the firm that can help them succeed.
Right.
It's the responsibility of HR. Some organizations do it in simple way. And I think even at PCO, when you join in, the first thing you get is a buddy. Yes, because you want to ensure the person has someone he can talk to whenever he has a challenge, whenever there's any issue, he can quickly take up his phone. It's not a formal relationship. It's mm-hmm. a very informal one that we set okay. between the new intake and an existing employee. Okay. So that person is able to carry you all the way
through the
period.
Okay, that's amazing. Okay, now it's time for us to get out of the serious snacks. We are doing all this now. So, who are you outside the workspace? We understand that you're all about like work because this is work. But at the end of the day, when you're not working and you're not in a suit and tie, what do you do? What are your hobbies? Yeah, do you sing, you dance, or I'll play some music so you can give us the
latest. Oh my God.
What do you do, or who are you outside work?
I don't change much because I'm especially now that work is all in our face.
Mm,
you know, it's all in our face. So, you know, these days it's pretty much difficult to separate when you're working.
The work-life balance.
So from your gadgets to it's all loaded in there. But at the same time, I think I love to sing. I love to sing. I love to
sing. Please drop a line.
Oh no no
wait,
no!
Wait. There's a song.
When I mean
when you say sing, do you actually mean chorister singing or?
We can start from the bathroom. Right. So if you give me a bathroom now,
okay,
I can.
Okay. So what's your favorite song?
Now I'm on the spot. Because I'm not sure I really like, I don't have favorite songs, but mm-hmm. I love music.
Okay.
I'm not particular about memorizing the songs mm-hmm. and all of that.
Okay, give us two lines. Just
I love good two music. Lines. Good music.
Like, okay, if you asked me to sing a song now, the first thing that comes to my mind is John Legend, All of Me, and I'm like,
okay, so I like
jazz. So I'm a fan of jazz and mm-hmm. contemporary music.
No, wait. So. Okay, let's try John Legend.
What if I don't know that?
See, I hope you have enjoyed today's episode. We'll continue the singing, in the back room. I hope you enjoyed, this episode and you've learned something, because that's the most important thing. Mm-hmm. For more information regarding the stock market, financial services, and if you want to do your research, log on to www.proshareng.com. Till next time, bye.